Members, it's the appointed time we have for quorum. I call the meeting to order. For the special finance committee meeting, we will start from 2 o'clock to 6:50. There are three sessions. The purpose of the meeting is to scrutinize the estimates of the government for 2023 and 2024 to ensure that the amount sought does not exceed the required amount under the policy. Let me remind members that the questions should be directly related to the budget and the estimates. If you would like to get written, if you would like to ask follow-up questions, please cite the reply number, say for example HYAB001. Members who would like to ask questions, please press the request to speak button. If you are unable to follow up on the administration's written reply, you can ask a questions in a written form. Please submit your questions before the end of the meeting to the secretariat. Supplementary written questions will be answered in the same format. I'll decide on the time allotted to each member, depending on the number of members waiting to speak. We only have 70 minutes for this session, so each member will have 3 minutes. First, I would like to ask to thank the secretary. You are here with us already. We'll hear from you. Thank you. I will speed up in my speech to give more time to members. I would like to brief members about the key areas of work of the Home and Youth Affairs Bureau and its departments. In December 2022, we released the Youth Development Blueprint outlining the overall vision and guiding principles for the government's long-term work in the future. There are more than 160 actions and measures put forward to cater for the needs of young people of different backgrounds. The Bureau will report regularly to the Legislative Council on the implementation progress, and the next area is promotion of young people's understanding of our country and the world. With the resumption of normal travel, and we will resume various international and mainland visit programs in an orderly manner. That includes over 320 mainland and overseas internship places with 24 large corporations and funding schemes. Our aim is to further promote young people's understanding of our world and our country. Regarding Poland Cook's Youth Hostel funded by the government and the Hong Kong United Youth Association's project approved under the subsidy scheme for using hotels and guest houses as youth hotels, the tenant recruitment exercises are underway. Together with the project by the Hong Kong Federation of Youth Groups, these three projects provide 2,000 hostel places. We'll continue to take forward the youth hostel scheme in collaboration with NGOs and other stakeholders. We'll continue with the Youth Participation Initiative to enable more young people to join government's advisory and statutory bodies. We will expand the member self-recommendation scheme for youth to increase the number of participating committees from 15 in Phase 5 to 20 in Phase 6. In order to encourage more young people to participate in district affairs, the Home Affairs Department established the District Youth Community Building Committee and the District Youth Development and Civic Education Committee in the 18 districts in early April this year. Each committee consists of 20 to 30 members, with one-third of the seats open up for young people to nominate themselves. The blueprint states that the multifaceted excellence scholarship scheme will continue to support students sitting in the Hong Kong DSE who excels in sports, arts and or community service to pursue undergraduate studies in local universities or tertiary institutions. We plan to allocate $100 million to extend the scheme to bolster young people's development in non-academic talents. The 23-24 budget sets aside $100 million to strengthen support for women's development. Starting from 23-24, the provisions will be injected into the Women Empowerment Fund rollout by the Chief Executive in his policy address, increasing the annual allocation to $20 million. The fund will subsidize women's organizations and related NGOs to launch suitable projects to support women, for example, providing training on child and elderly care, assistance for women in using new technologies, As always, the government will continue to work closely with the Committee on the Promotion of Civic Education in 23-24 to promote civic and national education, including national security education outside schools and in the community through various channels and diversified means, with a view to enhancing the public sense of civic responsibilities, awareness of the rule of law and patriotism. The government will set up district services and community care teams for short, in all districts. We've already made announcements in late March. The list of organizations selected for forming those teams in Tsuen Wan and Southern District. They will start their work soon. The others in the remaining 16 districts are at a selection stage. The government will provide part of the resources required, specifically a funding of about 800,000 to 1.2 million per care team for a 2-year service period, depending on the circumstances. The estimated provision for 23-24 is $226 million. The HAD currently provides support services to about 200,000 ethnic minorities annually through NGOs and district networks to facilitate integration. We'll continue to provide resources to 8 support service centers for ethnic minorities, targeting at ethnic minority youth and new arrivals, and to implement a district-based program for racial harmony to promote interaction and exchange between ethnic minorities and the local community. My colleagues and I are happy to answer questions from members. Thank you. Thank you, Secretary. As there are 19 members waiting to speak, each will have 3 minutes. Please make good use of the time. First, Mr. Lai Tong Kwok. My question is 061. Well, there is the Civil Education Resource Center. There are standing exhibitions and other activities. However, the participation rate is low. We have about hundreds or about 3,000 participants. In the previous few years, you could say that there was a suspension of operation explaining the low intake. But for 2022 and 23, over the 11 months, there are only 3,000 or so participants per day, less than 10. Do you think that's an acceptable figure? In relation to the resource center, there are thematic exhibitions as well. The intake is still low. Say, for example, those relating to national security, only 300 people turn up. Well, it's on the 7th floor of the youth square. It's a very good idea to use it to promote national security as well as patriotism. Well, have you put in place some KPIs or indicators? Say, for example, the number of people participating to make it a satisfactory performance. Does the administration accept the low turnout rate for the Civic Education Resource Center and its various activities? Do you think it's good use of resources? If you think it is problematic, do you have any plans to improve the turnout rate? Thank you for the question. In the past few years, indeed, because of the epidemic, activities as well as the number of participants have both dropped. As you know that it is situated in the youth square, we want to expand the use of the youth square to the community. We would like to make use of relevant measures to boost the popularity of the resource center. Apart from the Civic Education Resource Center, we make use of various activities under the Committee on the Promotion of Civic Education, on understanding of basic law, constitution, and civic awareness. Well, in relation to whether our activities and the use of the location is up to standard, we will review the utilization work plans relating to the resource center. We'll also look into enhancement measures to attract more participants to take part in the activities and use the center. Well, you haven't answered about KPIs. Anyway, let's wait for later. Mr. Andrew Lam. Is in relation to 176. regarding the promotion of Hong Kong in the international community and also on the mainland. Well, telling Hong Kong good stories of Hong Kong apart from the mainland, do you have any other measures? It's mentioned in this reply that there is funding of $50 million to a task force on promoting and branding Hong Kong headed by the FS. Do you have more information? What about details of preparation work? When will the events be launched? The $50 million, how many departments does it cover? Can I ask for details and allocation of funding? Secretary, thank you. I thank the member for the question. And indeed, in terms of telling good stories of Hong Kong, the government attaches a lot of importance to it. For the promotion of Hong Kong's unique advantages, the task force is headed by the highest echelon of the government. For details, I'll defer to the ISD. Director, thank you for the question. In relation to overseas promotion, there is a major theme, that is Hello Hong Kong. And there are four major areas. The first is to welcome visitors. That is to attract more visitors to come to Hong Kong for sightseeing and for business. For this part, as you know, at the inaugural ceremony, that we have about 500,000 free tickets distributed all over the world to promote Hong Kong so that they can see a new side of Hong Kong, the Palace Museum, M+, and West Kowloon Cultural District. The other area is to invite visitors to come. We want to invite 1,000 big guns in various areas, say for example from the media, from the political circle, to come to Hong Kong so that they can see with their own eyes what Hong Kong is like, so that they can tell the story of Hong Kong to their own respective spheres. Another area is to go global. At the beginning of February, the chief executive has led a delegation of about 30 people to go to the Middle East for a visit. As you understand that, there are a number of department secretaries that have conducted overseas visits. Next area is mega events. We want to attract more mega events to come to Hong Kong. We attach importance to cooperation, so for the same types of mega events, we put them in around the same time. This week, there is one on innovation and technology. There are many different events. Have you finished? Regarding our work and resources, what is the entire family of Hong Kong that's taken up the work, including the Development Bureau, the ISD, and the Trade Development Council. We use our own resources to take up the work. On top of existing resources in the budget, the FS has given us $50 million for the task force to see if new work has to be taken up. Your time's up. I think the majority of your question has been answered. Mr. Dominic Lee. I want to follow up on 145, that is the expenditure on mutual aid committees. According to your reply, in 2020 and 2023, you have used about $8 million. And in 2023-24, because of the disbandment of the MACs, you won't provide any allocations. Well, there are many different associations in different areas. Say, for example, under the election committee, they encounter difficulties in operation. I know that there are care teams, but there is only one such team in each district. So would you consider shifting the allocation from the AMCs to cover expenses incurred by these district associations? Regarding district associations that work, the expenditure incurred, and the challenges they encounter, we fully understand. Under the HAD, D, there is a district participation, community participation scheme for district associations to make applications to organized events. You asked that since MACs have been disbanded, can we allocate the funding to a different area? It will be difficult for us to do so because the funding allocation is to the MACs. When it's dispensed with, then it's gone. If there are other plans to, say, grassroots associations, that would be a separate scheme. Actually, apart from Mr. Lee, a number of members have asked questions in LegCo about the operation of district bodies. They encounter difficulties in the provision of services. As we've said, we have various schemes for them to make applications. We are happy to help these associations to ask for subsidies and funding to organize activities. If we rely solely on the government to provide services, that is not enough. We need to bring everyone together to make it work. So whenever feasible, we will support grassroots associations or district associations to organize activities. I understand about district resources, but a lot of these associations are concerned about district offices. Would you give them resources to rent premises? Because there must be vacant premises.
For the offices of the MAC, often they are located in public housing estates. If the local organizations find them suitable, then perhaps they can make an application to the housing authority. And for such organizations, the HYAB and the HAD will do our best to assist them. However, for these vacant offices, perhaps the housing authority has other uses for them. Thank you. Next, Mr. Chan Siu Hong. I would like to follow up on HYAB 017 and 107, a question of Mr. So Chen Wing. For the Women Empowerment Fund, they assist women in the transition in the employment market and to help them take on different roles in their daily life. In the administration's reply, it is said that the fund will replace the existing schemes in assisting women. Since the program has been effective, why don't we stick to the original program and start a new fund? I would like to know whether there are any actual new measures in assisting women and whether there will be more concrete KPIs. And it is said that about 100 activities have been organized, benefiting some 110,000 people. I believe that to assess how effective an activity is, you should not just look at a number of attendance. I would like to know whether you have kept a statistics to see how many people you have actually helped find employment. And for the Women Empowerment Fund, how will it work together with existing schemes from the Labour Department to assist women in employment? Secretary, the purpose for setting up the Women Empowerment Fund when compared with the previous funding scheme were actually the number of subsidies or subsidy concern was relatively lower. And for each individual organization, the subsidy they received is on the low end. And in our budget this year, money has been set aside. So we need to think about how we can utilize these resources. Yes, it is easier to simply increase the amount of subsidy, but can it achieve what we want? For the Women Empowerment Fund, other than empowering women, We also like to assist women from different walks of life. Let's say women in the grassroots level, how can we assist them in the employment market? How can we provide them with a platform to showcase their talent? That is the point of the WEF. We want to provide a platform for them to fulfill their potential. Thank you. Because of time, or perhaps a written reply is needed. Next, Ms. Nexi Lam. I would like to follow up on HYAB055 regarding the GBA Youth Employment Scheme. If we look at the trial scheme in 2021, a large number of applications were received, but at the end, only 1,100 applicants were recruited. Is it because of a mismatch of resource allocation? And when you are regularizing the scheme, how can you better match employees and employers? And after the implementation of this scheme, we have heard some comments from employers. How can we reflect on the experience and improve the effectiveness of this of the program? And will you relax the entry requirement to graduates of associate degree programs? Also, on HYAB068, do you actually have any concrete measures to promote the three major themes there? Is it just on promotion, or are there any actual concrete measures? But firstly, on the GBA Youth Employment Scheme, we put great importance on assisting our young people in seeking employment in the Greater Bay Area. Together with the LWB, we have made some discussions, especially on whether or not to relax the entry requirement. I believe that they have provided you with replies. In terms of assisting young people in seeking employment in the Greater Bay Area, we have put in a lot of effort. Through different types of exchange programs, young people can have a better understanding of the employment market in the GBA. It will make it easier for young people to secure a more suitable position for them through this scheme. As for HYAB068, for the Women's Commission, there is a task force on the promotion of the themes that you've mentioned. I'm sorry, it should be the Family Council. Other than the promotional committee, they also organize activities regularly to answer another member's question. We review the effectiveness of the works of different committees to see whether there are any new measures to be taken. These are the core values to be promoted, but we will constantly look into the possibility to see whether there are any new methods to promote these values. I'm sure that they can and will step up their efforts. Thank you. Next, Ms. Carmen Khan. HYAB047. It is also related to the Women Empowerment Fund, and 031 relating to youth affairs. Well, for now, you will consult with the Women's Commission, and more details will be rolled out in Q2. But do you have any ideas right now? Well, for organizations that are aware of this fund, that is $100 million, Will you consider having a matching scheme? And 031, the entrepreneurial scheme. Together with the Youth Development Council, you have rolled out a scheme in assisting youth entrepreneurship. Because of the pandemic, at the time, the program was quite short-lived, so there was no record of where the young entrepreneurs started their businesses. So do you have plans to compile statistics in this regard? I can see that you have a grand vision to collaborate with universities and other institutions in the mainland. So I have great expectation for the organizations who have already received funding. Where did they start their businesses? Thank you, Ms. Khan. First, on the Women Empowerment Fund. Right now, there is no matching arrangement in place. But when an organization is making an application, they can make such a request. We want to utilize or make good use of our resources. After they receive government funding, if there is a matching arrangement, does that facilitate its effectiveness? I thank you for your comment. I'm sure that it will be taken into account during the consideration process. As for the entrepreneurial schemes, because of the pandemic, many of our young entrepreneurs have been unable to return to the mainland to start their businesses. I've talked with some of them and understand that in the past few years, they have faced difficulties. Even though with government subsidies, it was very difficult for them to start their businesses in the mainland. But now, with the resumption of normal travel, gradually they have returned to the Greater Bay Area to start their businesses. We'll have more details later. Like you said, the Alliance of Entrepreneurial Bases is very important to us. So we would like to collect more details on their business sectors and other details to facilitate the alliance further. Next, Ms. Chen Hoyen. Question 044. About Happy Hong Kong, etc. Well, firstly, I have to commend colleagues of the HAD. With the participation of the HAD, I can see that the level of community participation has increased. But now there is no concrete details for the allocation of the $20 million for the Yau Tin Mong District Office. We have collaborated with them for street culture, busking or handicraft stores, they have been quite successful. It does not cost much, but we need to ensure a high level of youth participation. So I would like to know, how are you going to attract more young people to participate in marketplaces or carnivals like this? Second, many grassroots families were suffering in the past few years. They could not afford to travel overseas. In the past week, I saw some celebrations for the Thai New Year. Since they have been suffering in the past few years, it is good to see that they can enjoy themselves now. And on youth hostel. Tourism is now resuming normal, so I would like to know whether it is still feasible to transform hotels into youth hostels.
Secretary, thank you for the question, and I thank Ms. Chen for her support of our work. Well, we work under the spirit of district affairs can help you. We organize various activities. In the gourmet marketplace under Happy Hong Kong campaign, as Ms. Chen mentioned, can we bring gourmet of different countries to people in Hong Kong? That's our intention. There will be different themes in the gourmet marketplace, and we will have global gourmet. We also would like to showcase delicacies in southern China. There will be different bazaars on food. Well, as Ms. Chen said, people have been cooped up for a number of years. We would like to help them under our spirit. In relation to details of Happy Hong Kong, I'm sure the FS shares the same idea as that of Ms. Chen. We would like to make use of Happy Hong Kong to bring happiness back to Hong Kong people after years of being trapped here. So we'll divulge more information later. About youth hostel, can I answer that as well? Please do. We are still confident that we are able to turn hotels and guest houses into youth hostels. We'll be able to meet our objective. The confidence doesn't just come from the dedication of the Bureau. We understand that there are a lot of people who share our ideas, who would like to do something. They are from the hotelier, from the business sector, from district or organizations or youth organizations. They don't care about profits, but they are willing to participate in our scheme. Now we've announced the subsidy scheme for using hotels and guest houses as youth hostels. We've heard some positive news, and I'm sure we'll be able to give you details later. Next, Mr. Michael Tian, I'd like to follow up on 185. Well, there will be an increase of 99% to $35 million on the media. I'm sure that there will be more resources to tackle misinformation and false information and to uphold our image. But no matter how much you use, I think it's not as effective as legislation. I've been following up on this topic. In 2022, and on the 14th of February, I asked the former Department Secretary whether he would look into legislation. The answer was that, at the end of the year, there will be an answer. There is none. And I asked a question in the LegCo about misinformation. The Secretary for Security said that the HAB was looking into overseas practice, and they have also engaged a consultant to conduct studies on different jurisdictions of various legislations to tackle false information. So still, the reply is to clarify more and to increase manpower. If clarification is all it takes, then you don't need to do so much. I raise this because of the national anthem incident. We have many different sports events. You don't know when it will happen again. The crux of the problem is the search. There is nothing we can do about Google because there is no legislation to invoke. There was a European Union case that ended in an order to Google to remove untrue information. So can the HYAB step on it to work on tackling false information? Thank you for the question. And indeed, Mr. Tian has been following up on this issue. I can feel how anxious he is. Other legislators have also touched on this on different platforms. As Mr. Tian said, we have devoted more resources to clarify misinformation and untrue information. We understand that we have to dispel untrue information, so we'll do everything we can, and legislators have helped us a lot. In relation to legislation, just like Mr. Tian and other members, we are very cautious. We need to consider different legislations and its implementation effectiveness in different jurisdictions to tackle disinformation. We see a trend in different jurisdictions, say for example in Germany or the EU, UK, US, Singapore, they had adopted an approach of legislation to tackle disinformation. But there is no one country that depends on one single legislation as a panacea, say for example, covering the internet or elections. The consultant is close to finalizing the report. We're looking at the details. In the process, we've spoken to the Security Bureau and the Department of Justice. They're also involved in our work. We hope that in the near future, we'll be able to give you a reply. So what about Google? That's not answered. What measures do you have? Your time's up. You'll have to wait for a written reply. Well, the consultant report is finished, about to finish. Mr. Sunny Tan, I would like to ask about 157, that is in relation to Klansmen associations. But during the Black Lives violence and social unrest, Klansmen associations have taken up a lot of district work and they have acted as a bridge between Hong Kong and the mainland. Do you have any plans to establish a standing communication channel between Klansmen associations and district offices so that these associations can be included in district administration? I'd like to see if there are detailed plans to help these associations to enhance internal governance and to establish youth associations to attract youngsters to participate and to make their contribution to groom talents in Hong Kong. Secretary, thank you for the question. We've always attached a lot of importance to liaison with Klansmen associations. Under the HAD, we make use of a scheme the Know Your Homeland Klansmen Association subsidy scheme to organize activities. In the 25th anniversary of reunification, we have organized a number of activities with them. Well, actually, in the council meeting and or in other meetings, we have mentioned about the contributions made by Klansmen associations in Hong Kong, and we are very grateful for their work. We'll work very closely with these associations on district work. In terms of youngsters, of course, we encourage youngsters to participate via different associations to serve Hong Kong. We encourage Klansmen associations to organize different activities to attract youngsters' participation. We believe that by taking part, youngsters will know about their homeland, their hometown, know more about their roots, and it would enhance the understanding of the country's history. We encourage Klansmen associations to organize activities for youngsters and encourage youngsters to participate. When we talk to youngsters, I myself have had meetings with Klansmen associations as well. We would like them to make good use of their own network. They can make use of the network of their hometown to organize activities for youngsters. And in this way, youngsters will understand better about the stories of Hong Kong, stories of the country. In relation to governance, are your time's up? You have to wait for a written reply. So far, 24 members have pressed the request to speak button. So it will exceed 70 minutes. I'll draw a line. Please make good use of your time and be succinct. Mr. Vincent Chang, I'd like to follow on 134, that is in relation to management of private buildings, particularly three new buildings. The HAD has been helping these buildings to enhance management and to hold meetings. But you do need to do more. There are more and more old buildings and more issues to address. And in the epidemic, a lot of buildings can't undergo maintenance. Well, apart from the Building Management Professional Advisory Service scheme, last year there was also a pilot scheme to engage property management companies and organizations to assist in management. That's near the end of that scheme. What is its effectiveness? I know that as a result of the scheme, so many buildings have formed owners corporations. I hope this will continue. Will you collect information to map out the way forward? Well, there will be a joint management to apportion and share expenditure. These are very good ideas. Will you take them on board?
Thank you, Mr. Chang, for the question. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Chang and members who care about grassroots. They've been helping the HAD to provide services to grassroots as well as those living in 3-nil buildings. Their assistance has been very helpful. You mentioned a couple of schemes. Well, I would like to thank the member for his recognition. In a panel meeting, it was mentioned that the work to improve building management is something that the HAD is seriously considering as to whether there are new approaches, new ways to more effectively assist owners of units in 3-nil buildings to manage their own building. We would like them to fulfill their own duties and to enhance their understanding and provide technical assistance. Well, concepts like joint management and expansion of our schemes are possible ways that we've been considering. Members, if you have any suggestions, do tell us. We need to seriously look into more effective new ways to assist owners of units in 3-nil buildings to improve management. Next, Mr. Kenneth Leung. I would like to follow up on 083. Well, it's about the youth development blueprint rollout last year. Of course, a successful blueprint will receive dedicated resources to roll out 160 measures. I have a few things to ask. Well, there is this $171 million, in particular in relation to mainland exchanges. Well, different organizers told us that there has been an increase in transportation cost. Well, the deadline for application is March, and they've identified a number of issues in their quotation. Do you have any ways to help these organizers? To help them to successfully conduct these exchange activities, say for example, bulk buy, transportation tickets, etc. Every year there is only one application window for NGOs to apply for funding for these exchanges. With the full resumption of travel, there will be more of these exchanges. It's difficult to plan all the tours for the year within this year. Would you consider putting in place more application periods? Will there be any implications on funding?
Secretary, Yes, we agree. It has only been a short while since the resumption of normal travel, but many activities have been organized already. Of course, we understand that there were challenges, like for traffic expenses, like you said. So we are now looking into the possibility of relaxing certain requirements so that it will make it easier for these organizations to apply. Undersecretary? Yes, we have noticed a rise in traffic expenses. And when applications are made for these exchanges, we have set certain amount for traffic expenses. But there is some buffer room. Since our country has a comprehensive high-speed rail network, in this time of challenges, I'm sure that that can be helpful. Please try to relax the restrictions. Yes, thank you. Next, Dr. So Chen Wang. I would like to thank the HYAB for the detailed replies that they have given for my five questions. Well, I have a follow-up questions regarding question 105. In 2019, it was announced that the Alliance of Hong Kong Youth Innovative and Entrepreneurial Basis in the Greater Bay Area would be established. But now it is still not yet completed. I've asked this question before, and the reply that I was given was that because of the pandemic, we have to wait for further progress. This seems like an endless wait. I was quite surprised by the reply. It has been over 3 years, and the alliance is still not yet established. You can't just blame it all on the pandemic. So I would like to know whether this alliance will still go ahead and what kind of resources will be allocated to support the alliance. And along the same vein, HYAB 104. From your reply, you said that there have been about 3,000 young people joining the government through the Member Self-Recommendation Scheme for Youth. There were only 510 posts in your committees. So what happened to the rest of the participants? You can't just set them aside and raise their enthusiasm. So I would like to know, how are you going to handle them? Well, for the first question, it was similar to Ms. Carmen Khan's, so please be succinct. Well, Dr. So, your question was similar to that of Ms. Khan, and I have given a reply. But I would like to emphasize that none of our colleagues shirk their responsibilities or their duties. Each and every one of us is devoted to serving the community. For the past few years, during the pandemic, young entrepreneurs were unable to start their businesses in the Greater Bay Area. Once they have established their base there, we will kickstart the alliance as soon as possible. This is also mentioned in the Youth Development Blueprint. We have been in touch with young entrepreneurs, and they have told us that they need a platform for communication. So I can assure you that we can establish this alliance within this year. So I assure you there is no shirking of responsibility here. As for the 510 posts, will it affect the enthusiasm of the young members? Well, if you have read the Youth Development Blueprint, in the 18 districts, we are setting up two new committees. That means there will be some 30-odd committees. This is to create more places for young people to participate in local affairs. Thank you. Next, Mr. Tong Li-Tae. HYAB 014-028. For the capacity building village program, it is operated by the Hong Kong Metropolitan University. If we look at the age group for the past 3 years, people age 50 or above accounted for over 80%. In the past 3 years, female participants accounted for over 80% as well. The Metropolitan University could not provide us with statistics on the attendance of students. I find it quite unsatisfactory. If they cannot provide us with the attendance of students, we cannot assess the effectiveness. I wonder if you have any follow-up in place. Once they have completed their studies, did the courses that they've taken assist in their employment? And we should also limit the overlapping of resources in the capacity building village program. Thank you. Together with the Women's Commission, when we were designing this mileage program, what was the intention actually at the time? We wanted to instill more confidence in women in their employment prospect and their abilities. The program is to empower women. It is not a career-oriented program. That being said, this program has been in place for a period of time, so we believe now is a good time to review the program. Whether or not we should adopt any new approaches in terms of curriculum design, mode of teaching, etc. Do they fulfill the original intention of this program, that is to instill confidence of women from all walks of life, be it taking care of family or taking part in the employment market, etc.? Chair, I would like to see the HKMU to keep statistics on the attendance of students. Yes, we'll see to that. Thank you. Next, Mr. Stephen Ho. I would like to follow up on HYAB 032, a question from Mr. Vincent Cheng. That is the gourmet experiences, fun, amusements, and exciting ambience of the Happy Hong Kong campaign. In the reply, it is said that some 20 million will be set aside for the implementation of the relating activities. I'm sure that I have raised these issues in the past relating to carnivals organized by the fishery sector. Well, if these activities are organized only once a year or twice a year, then the demand of young people may not be met when we need to apply for venues. a permit will be issued to us, stating that no monetary transaction can be done, then that is very difficult for our purpose here. In collaborating with the HAD, is it possible to relax such limitation for us in the fishery sector? All we want was to recover the cost. If we need to go through the hurdles of redeeming tickets, etc., that makes things very difficult. These guidelines were set decades ago to ensure fairness. But now, can we streamline things to facilitate youth groups and organizations? This can ensure the 20 million and other government money is properly spent. Thank you. I understand that what you have suggested is not directly related to the Happy Hong Kong Gourmet Marketplace, but I understand your concern. Let's say for the fishery sector, when they promote their products through certain activities, how can we facilitate that? The chief executive has said in his policy address in the fourth quarter last year, the HAD has organized some weekend marketplaces. That was to accumulate experience for FEHD colleagues to handle any future marketplaces. And through this gourmet marketplace, we can look into whether there is any possibility to further relax restrictions to facilitate similar activities from other sectors. Thank you. We'll follow up on that later. Next, Mr. Lam Chun Seng. Thank you. Question 017. Question from Mr. Chen Xiu Hong. $100 million. To support women's development. Well, you were helping women take up different roles in the job market. This is something that the ELB is doing as well. And similar courses are also provided through the Capacity Building Mileage Program. For these women, perhaps they are good at taking care of children, but somehow no childcare services are provided for them. I'm concerned about the fact that there may be some overlapping of government resources. And question 064 on youth hostels. For the one in Tai Po, Po Hern Street, over 40% of tenants there have lived there for over 3 years. For the remaining 60%, they've moved out. What was the reason? After they have moved in for a period of time, do you conduct review on their income or assets to see whether they are still suitable to have a place in a youth hostel? For the $100 million set aside for the Women Empowerment Fund, this will sponsor activities and programs in supporting women's development. Like what you suggested, we do not want to overlap with other resources providing similar activities. So for childcare services, I understand that the SWD is looking into any enhancement measures. So what is the intention of this fund? We want to empower women from all walks of life, including grassroots women. and professional women, etc. We want to give them a platform to fulfill their potential and their talents. We provide employment training, and a platform for women to showcase their achievements. As for working mothers, we want to help them balance the stress that they face when taking care of their family and in their work life. So the fund will not overlap with any existing resources.
Next, Mr. Chen Yong, thank you. First, I would like to follow up on 027, that is in relation to subsidy schemes on exchange programs. Well, I myself and DAB and the New Territories Federations, well, talked about these activities. There is this pop festival. Can you ensure that new ways will be used to enhance attractiveness? And for 002, we see that the number of places has been increased by 50% compared to the year before, but the estimates only increased by about by 10% or so. Why is it the case? Well, do you have new criteria? Can you give me information about number of places? And 063 in relation to the self-recommendation scheme, there are 510 posts. Well, there is a high mobility among youngsters. Some have left their posts. What are the reasons? Well, do you have any ways to select the best candidate? Can you give me the reply number again? It's 063. Is in relation to 510 places. Secretary, please be succinct. So 027, the exchange program, whether we will invite the National Exchange Association, we welcome any ideas that promote youth exchanges. 002. Well, the number under international exchange program is lower than those of the mainland because in order to resume exchange sessions, we have to consider our capacity after resumption of travel. That's why there is a lag and a smaller number. The Youth Development Council will keep tab on how to make better use of resources for the two types of exchanges to help youngsters. Mr. Kenneth Leung also touched on one point. We're aware that youth associations encounter challenges when they organize exchange programs. We try to remove barriers and make relaxations for these organizers to hold these exchange programs. About 510 posts. For the self-recommendation scheme, there are 510 places under the member self-recommendation scheme for youth. In the policy address, it's mentioned that the number of places will be increased. We've started with the application for the next phase. We hope that more committees will set aside places for youngsters under the scheme. Well, I've already drawn the line, so no more new members joining. Next, Mr. Ma Fung Kwok. It's in relation to 006, also about the member self-recommendation scheme for youth. In the reply, the administration said that the number of committees will increase from 15 to 20 to 20, covering more committees that are of interest to youngsters. How do you decide what policy areas are more attractive to youngsters? Have you conducted any stakeholders consultation? Can you give us information about the additional 5 committees? Thank you for the question. For your first question, how do we decide which committees are of interest to the youngsters? We look at figures. We look at committees with more applications from youngsters, then we know where the interests lie. We make contact with youngsters in youth associations so we understand what they like. We encourage committees under different departments to open application for members under the member self-recommendation scheme. We are starting the next phase. In due course, we will provide more information about committees to members. We will announce the committees for the scheme when we announce applications. So you have not done any consultation about the increase of committees. No, we have not consulted anyone about the selection of committees, but we look at figures. We see the number of applications from youngsters for certain committees. And when we drafted the youth development blueprint, we have attended over 170 consultation sessions. We got an idea about what they are interested in, say art, sports, sustainable development. When we talk to departments about possible opening up of places in committees, we talk about committees of these areas. Mr. Kenneth Falk. Well, Mr. Ma has asked about 043, so I will move on to 044 and 006. So in relation to the Multifaceted Excellence Scholarship Scheme covering arts, students excelling in sports, arts, community service. In the past 4 years, what is the ratio of those that are awarded this under the scheme in sports, arts, and community service? I understand that there are more places under sports. Perhaps it's easier to get the award under the scheme in this area. Well, this scheme has been running for 5 years. In theory, it should be doing better. But let's look at the number of awardees. 2019, 46, 2021, 22, 33. With the same amount of resources, how come the number of awardees has dropped? I want to ask about 006 in relation to the member self-recommendation scheme for youth. 90% of the applicants agreed to join the think tanks of the government. Now there are about 2,900 people. The scheme will be more popular, there will be more applications. What about those unsuccessful ones? Would you approach them? Otherwise, once they have the information has been entered into the Central Personality Index, then it's like falling into a black hole. You need to use the information. In relation to the Multifaceted Excellence Scholarship Scheme, there are 238 awardees in sports, arts, community service. 123, there is more. About 50% of them are under the sports realm, 61 under the arts realm, music 54, well, 61 including arts and music, and 54 are under the community service. So we see the performance of youngsters in different areas. About the Central Personality Index, Well, you may notice that one of the measures under the blueprint is to set up a youth network. It covers youngsters who have applied under various schemes of the government. We make use of this network to make regular contact, to give them information about the government, and to encourage them to make applications, to take part in different schemes and programs. That's exactly what we want to achieve, to follow up after they have entered the Central Personality Index. That's why we will set up the network. Six members are still waiting. This session will be extended to 3:30. The next session will start at 3:35. Next, Mr. Michael Lok. Thank you. I want to follow up on 180 and 181 in relation to government publicity. Well, now everyone's talking about telling good stories of Hong Kong and those of our country. In the reply, there is information about APIs, click rates, views, and production cost. I can't tell whether the hit rate is high or low, or the click rate is high or low, because compared to celebrities, government clips are not as popular or as attractive. But compared to APIs of publicity clips of our country, those of Hong Kong are not as close to everyone's lives, not as humorous. They just tell things straightforward without any fun facts. But when it comes to interaction online, you have to share. Well, we have influencers here. There are many of them in the community. There are also small production houses with brilliant ideas. Are there mechanisms to ask small production houses to provide ideas? Or to engage them to produce in these materials? The most important thing is idea, because nowadays equipment's getting cheaper. So if you make the material more interesting, then it will boost hit rate. Do you have any ideas? Thank you, Mr. Lok. I will defer to the ISD. Mr. Chen, please. Thank you for the question. Indeed, yes. Regarding APIs, they are broadcast via different channels, 41 channels, radio stations, TV stations, and at government premises. So if you only look at the click rate on YouTube, you can't tell the full picture. We put our materials on YouTube so that we will have more exposure on the social media platform. It is also an archive for the media or for our department to find the clips easier. In relation to the approach, I fully agree with Mr. Lok. There is a lot of room for us to improve. We will collect views. Well, sometimes the click rate shows the inadequacies of some of our materials. So we will diversify. We will engage different companies. We've heard your views. Next, Mr. Yu Pak Leung. I would like to follow up on 002. The Bureau said that they will use $124 million to boost mainland exchange programs and internship covering 20 4,800 youngsters so that their horizons can be broadened. I support that. But I have some questions. Experience told us that for these internship programs to succeed, you have to identify suitable enterprises and positions so that so the participants can actually learn something. Well, the programs have been suspended for a number of years. Do you have any measures to ensure that you'll find suitable places and suitable enterprises? Well, apart from encouraging youngsters to take up internship on the mainland, would you do it the other way around to provide opportunities for mainland youngsters to come to Hong Kong to take up internship posts? We want to compete for talents. If someone's been here when they are studying, then they would be more inclined to come over, and in a certain way this will also alleviate our manpower shortage.
Thank you for your question. In the past few years, the suspended programs have been resumed gradually. For the Mainland Youth Exchange Program and internship program, they have been reactivated. And within a short period of time, 24 enterprises have been contacted and have provided some 300 positions for our participants. There are many well-intentioned people willing to assist the government in our youth development work. We will continue to step up our effort and increase the number of positions offered. And for these various exchanges and internships, we also extend invitation to our counterparts. We invite young people from that particular location to come to Hong Kong for exchange and internship as well. Through Hong Kong young people, we want to tell good stories of Hong Kong and attract young people from other places to come to Hong Kong to conduct exchanges or even develop their career further in Hong Kong. We have to leave the meeting room by 3:30. Thank you. Next, Mr. Johnny Chen. Reply 031. Some of the colleagues have touched on this as well. Well, you have mentioned that you will arrange for the entrepreneurs to return to the mainland as soon as possible. Can you give us a timetable? Some 130 million have been approved for various organizations. Are there any performance indicators to assess the effectiveness of the program and how we can enhance it further? And once the program is implemented, what kind of support can we offer to these teams and any follow-up actions? Secretary. As to when these young people can return to the mainland to start their businesses. Actually, things are underway already. After the resumption of normal travel and with the pandemic subsiding, they have returned to mainland and kick-started their businesses. And when we get our hands on the details, within this year, we will establish the Alliance of Entrepreneurs. As for performance indicators and effectiveness of these projects, yes, we have them in place. Perhaps I'll invite Commissioner for Youth to let us know more. We have some objective indicators. will invite these NGOs to conduct an assessment, such as stating the benefits that they have gained from the projects, etc. So this is a simple answer from me. Any follow-up? No. Ms. Jovi Chen, thank you. I would like to follow up on my question, HYAB021, and a question from Mr. Michael Look, question 179, regarding my question. On youth hostel, I understand that you have enhanced the speed of completion. Can you provide us with tenancy figures? As for the question from Mr. Look, on many international sporting events, the wrong national anthem was played. For the EU, regarding misinformation, there are legislations in place demanding fines. Perhaps the government and public organizations can refrain from placing advertisements from these websites. For the year 2023-24, the financial budget is at 180 million. Does that include placing advertisements on Google? If yes, what is the breakdown? For the tenancy rate of youth hostels, they have been quite full. As for the Poland Cook Youth Hostel, once application was opened, the number of applications received was at the maximum capacity. As for the Hong Kong United Youth Association Believing Youth Hub, it is also fully occupied. For the 80 hostel places, they are all occupied. For the Poland Cook Youth Hostel, there are 1,680 places. For the first phase, there are 500 places and they have received over 2,000 applications. As for the Believing Youth Hub in Causeway Bay, there are 194 places. They have received over 3,000 applications and they are going through the applications as we speak. Thank you. As for advertisement expenses, perhaps we can supply the relevant information after the meeting. Thank you. Next. Well, thank you. I would like to follow up on my question 094 on youth hostel. I would like to commend the HYAB on the implementation of the youth hostel scheme. The scheme has been in place for a few years now. For the youth hostel in Tai Po, in 2021, it was oversubscribed by 12 times, and in 2022 by 500%. And for the youth hostel in Yuen Long, it was oversubscribed by 400%. If we compare this figure with the waiting line of the public rental housing, young people may find that the youth hostel is a better option. I would like to know, how do you assess young people's need for youth hostels? We can see that the oversubscription figure is not very high, so does that mean young people do not need youth hostel places? Second, will the government consider having a one-stop platform to process these applications? For a young person, is it possible for them to apply for several places at different youth hostels? At the end of last year, in this very same room, we have approved the $1 billion for the scheme to transform hotels into youth hostels. So will we have any new plans in this regard? Commissioner for Youth, please. Thank you. I think we cannot compare youth hostel with PRH because the youth hostels do a lot more than just solving accommodation needs. We want to empower young people. And we want to provide some assistance in life planning and career planning, etc. I can see that the response has been very positive. And if there are some more popular areas included, I'm sure that the number will go up. If young people apply for more than one youth hostels, that is fine by us, but they can only secure a place in one youth hostel. And lastly, well, I can tell you that we have received a second application from a hotel, and we will announce details soon. Thank you. So this concludes this session. Thank you, Secretary. Thank you. Now we'll take a 5-minute break, and we'll resume at 3:30. Thank you.